When Tate Modern opened in the year 2000, an artist who's internationally acclaimed, but still unknown to many, had the very first show here. And she made a huge impact with her giant spider, which she calls Maman, or Mother. Now, Tate Modern's hosting a major retrospective of this artist, whose work, full of fear, rage, wit and desire, encapsulates and leaps on from the avant-garde art of the 20th century. You feel the violence and explosiveness of that century in her work. Mysterious, fantastic, volcanic. Always a maverick, close to every art movement, but a member of none. Her work has moved the century on. This tiny woman, nearly a century old, is one of the giants of modern art, and she's still working today. Louise Bourgeois has lived in this house for nearly 50 years. She'll be 96 this Christmas and no longer goes out.
Hi, Alan.
Hi,
Terry. Thank you very much.
She's asleep now in her bedroom on the ground floor. This is where she spends all her time. She has arthritis and insomnia. She's been up most of the night.
She has a curious relationship.
Jerry Gorovoy has been her closest companion since the early 80s. Her husband died in 1973.
This is Louise's husband, Robert Goldwater, who was the founding director of the Museum of Primitive Art. Okay. Yeah, that's Rob Storr.
Who's now her biographer, which has been going on for about 20 years at least.
A long time, yeah.
Robert was saying she doesn't quite want the process to end.
Yeah, it's a, you know, like every relationship with Louise, it's complex.
How are you doing?
Nowadays, the world has to come to her.
Hi. Hello.
For years now, Louise has been holding salons at her house where other artists can bring their work to show her. Robert Storr often sits by Louise's side.
When you said, can you talk about your work, the problem is getting me to stop talking about my work.
No, but actually you have not talked about your works.
Well, I guess...
You have talked about the making of the work, but you haven't talked about the motivation, what is it you want to express. You haven't told us that.
I'd say that's like trying to analyze a letter out of a word in a sentence.
This is an analogy. Yeah, I ask you an explanation and you give me an analogy.
It's the best I can do.
No, but you try harder.
Well?
The oxygenation of her environment with other people's miseries and other people's stories and other people's work is what the salon is really about.
No, but I'm not interested in that. Mm-hmm. Did it do a lot of good to you?
It's like group therapy.
Did it improve you?
And when you say group therapy, it's therapy for the group and therapy for Louise, too.
Well, Louise is, you know, she can be very perverse. She loves to see people going at each other. Louise's art is about life. You know, she doesn't want anyone coming talking about historical bullshit.
And these are really direct and yet very sensitive.
It's an incredible act of generosity. You're told to come Sunday afternoon, 3 o'clock. She still wears clothes rather like, you know, a girl from a Sickert painting or something. But she sits like a bird. She was really, and she was just eating, she loves chocolates. And people bring their work. And she say, well, what is this? Why did you make this? Do you hate this person?
I want my work to speak for itself.
And what is it you wanted to express? We have to know.
Tell Louise exactly what you wanted.
It's about the torment of being an artist.
The torment?
Yeah.
But it's absurd. It's not a torment to be an artist.
Yes, it is.
The premise is idiotic. It is not a torment to be an artist. It is a privilege.
She's very direct, isn't she? I mean, there's no intellectual pretension.
Yeah, where did that image come from and why does it matter to you? Why did you do it at all? Have you been to one of these?
I'm going.
Late this September, my turn came. I was invited to Louise's salon.
First time, second time?
First. How about you?
First.
Hello there.
Hi, W.Y.
Johan. Nice to meet you.
It's a full house here. Wow, you're a regular. Yeah. What do you get from this then?
I like seeing other people's works or poems or videos, so it's, and I love Louise's work.
This is Anna.
Voilà, Anna, qui est là, qui est là.
How are you?
I'm fine, how are you?
Yeah, good.
It's a pleasure to be here.
Bonjour.
This is a friend of mine near a painting, and this is some dried plant.
That's good. Thank you.
You should show that around to the whole sample.
It's remarkable that this woman, who's known artists like Miro, Bonnard, Léger, Marcel Duchamp, can still give so much time and so much of the energy she has left to these young artists.
Now her short-term memory and even her long-term memory are very fragile and sometimes just not there.
What's your name?
My name is Alfred Steiner. I was here a couple weeks ago.
She's a little bit like a frog on a lily pad who just sits there and sits there and sits there and the fly comes by and out darts the tongue.
Experimenting with watercolors and this is the first one I really like.
So, you know, she'll sit at the salon and nothing seems to be happening and then she'll seize on something that's of interest to her.
Yes, I like that.
Something that she can use.
So did you make that clay here?
No, this I made in Sèvres.
Oh, I see.
I'm working in the studio that did a lot of things for you, too.
Okay.
I make lots and lots of these little things in the studio.
I'm a prisoner of my memories. I have been a prisoner of my memories, and my aim is to get rid of them.
Every material has a home or a purpose, her interest in soft materials.
Her parents were tapestry restorers, weren't they?
They were.
And she grew up with this smell of yarn and the way that this very fluid and uncontrollable material became pictures, became whole worlds. And I think she's never left that. The softness and the mutability of cloth.
Louise was born in France in 1911 and lived here in Aubusson during the First World War. Her work is haunted by memories of her childhood. She's always recreating the intense emotions she felt then. Her mother came from a long line of tapestry makers. They always lived by rivers because the process required so much water.
She learnt to sew when other children were learning to hold a knife and a fork. So the hands are associated with creativity at an incredibly early age. Even now, when she's so frail, her hands are not at rest.
No.
So she sits at that desk and she's using her hands.
Elle vivait entourée de bobines, de fils, de vieilles tapisseries. Et donc c'est à la fois une pratique et aussi une métaphore qu'on va retrouver plus tard dans les grands hommages qu'elle fera à sa mère en, sous forme d'araignée.
My childhood has never lost its magic. It has never lost its mystery and it has never lost its drama. I refuse to let go of that period because, painful as it was life itself.
The pain started, she says, before she was even born.
My father would say, nobody wants a girl. Everybody wants a boy, but nobody wants a girl. I wanted a son. who would look like me and have my name. So I entered this world by displeasing.
There are amazing photographs of that period, and you can see her household and her father.
The central trauma for Louise was that her father hired a governess called Sadie and then had a long affair with her.
My mother tolerated it. And this is the mystery.
You can see Sadie, and she was very much part of the family, and how weird that must have been.
Sadie was engaged to teach us English. I thought she was going to like me, instead of which she betrayed me. I was betrayed not only by my father, damn it, but by her too. It was a double betrayal.
The houses in which she was brought up echoed with secrets and deceptions. This is where one used to be, in Choisy-le-Roi, on the River Seine, just south of Paris. It's long been demolished, but she's always rebuilding it in her work.
This is the house in Choisy, and it became for me the symbol, as you see up there, of the past being getting rid of by the present. The present destroys the past every day. And that cruelty is expressed by the guillotine.
We were sitting talking together, and she was telling a story from her childhood, and she just started to cry. Out of nowhere, she was back at that emotional state. And it gives you an idea of how much is bottled up and how deep, deep, deep it cuts.
She becomes overcome by certain moods and feelings, and they're so strong that she can't control them. And I think she uses her art to control them and understand them. And I think that's what the art's all about.
That amazing memory that she has that epitomizes how awful her father was. He used to occupy the top seat at the table, and the family would be gathered around. He'd drone on and on, obviously bore them silly, and she'd be a little girl in her white frock, and she'd sit there pummeling the bread from inside her baguette, and she'd make a little person out of the bread, and you know, quietly she'd just pluck the limbs off one by one, and it was her act, symbolic act of revenge against her father. That dealing with emotion by occupying her hands is just so deeply ingrained in her.
Chaque fois que mon père était en colère et ma mère avait l'impression qu'il allait se fâcher et frapper mon père, ma mère avait mis une assiette à côté de lui et... C'est pourquoi je déteste la céramique.
Seven bodies with double heads, hugging, making love in the same bed. So it's full of resonances of passion and relationships and her very earliest memories of a family, you know, at odds with itself.
Yes, a so-called close family, if you like, which clearly where there were all kinds of secrets hidden away.
Yeah. And this is a very explicit work. I mean, you can see the genitalia, the bodies are touching.
Louise was often put in the middle of adult dramas that she didn't understand. She really wants to know why she is so frightened. She really wants to know what she can do with this enormous energy that wells up in her and why these contradictions which bedevil her cannot be resolved.
Jerry has come over from New York to help install the Tate show.
This is the child entering the parents' room.
The spectator could become disoriented in the way that the child entering the adult's bedroom might be disoriented.
Because you're basically looking at a scene that's in a mirror. I mean, it's sort of like Alice in Wonderland. Or, you know, you're looking at something
and in a totally different way. And I think that is the child's point of view. Yes. The toy train, which is a reference to the child entering, but it also has a sexual thing, the idea. But definitely the red shape is, you know, the child perceives danger. Whether it sees the parents having sex or whatever, if there's something in the room, the red, the color of red is about intensity, blood. I mean, there's something, the child's view of what's going on between the parents.
But it's also like spying on her parents, isn't it? Was it her parents that she would have heard or spied on or thought about? It would have been her father with his lover. Of course her parents' bedroom wasn't like that.
Mm.
It's how she feels that it was on her terms of memory, which makes it really interesting. Other things, like this bed, for example, which is absolutely brilliant.
I need my memories. They are my documents.
She's not in denial. She doesn't say, I'm over that now. She keeps returning back and to redefine and rethink and question what the events was, what the feelings were and what the memories were. And this is why it's useful work for people.
As I look around the studio, there's so much that you have in common. Look at this, look.
I have been to hell and back, and let me tell you, it was wonderful. I mean, I could have written that, I could have done, but I didn't. Up there, I've got a white piece of linen with pale blue text on it. Oh, but this is not the blue one, this is the white one, but look. No, not now, in between my dreams.
These are, of course, her insomnia drawings.
I love this book.
You know this book? Yeah, of course
yeah.
You do. You know one of her phrases? She talks about the volcanic unconscious.
These are not patterns. These are not shapes. These are coming from the inner space inside her psyche. And all she's doing is showing us what they look like. And that's what's so amazing about them.
She said, we're digging out memories. There she is. Digging.
Yeah, but look at all these roots going down to the centre of the earth.
Elle raconte un souvenir assez tragique de son enfance. Quand elle s'est jetée dans la Bièvre pour se noyer, une forme de suicide, son père l'a rattrapée. Et donc ce souvenir assez traumatisant de se jeter dans la Bièvre quand elle était jeune fille revient dans des rêves, dans des dessins.
On the back of this drawing, done on her 83rd birthday, she's written, drowning in the river, the rain on the water, and the complete silence. Doing this drawing gives me the courage to save myself. And here she says, night. What do you think of during the night?
This is precious liquids. This is supposed to be, you know, the whole sexual awakening in a way, the whole bed, the wetness on the bed and all that. It is this idea. And the glass representing the muscles of the body and the idea when there's tension, the body releases a liquid fluid, whether it's orgasm or tears or snot or whatever it is.
Now, you have to understand that tapestries were everything for us at home, for the whole family. In the tapestries, a lot of people were naked. I mean, it was embarrassing. The woman would say, oh, I don't want that. I don't want some things like this on my wall. And because of these genitals, my father couldn't sell the tapestries. It became my role to take out the genitals and replace them with a bunch of flowers.
At the age of 18, she took a job as a guide at the Louvre, alongside men invalided out of the First World War.
I was allowed to go in the basement to have lunch with the staff. It was a hell of people who were amputated. So all the people who had legs, the leg was cut off, the arm was gone, they were all in that basement eating their lunch, right? And I had such revulsion that I had to do something with the legs. This is going to be called topiary, the art of improving nature. That is to say, the more you cut the branches, the more they are going to grow. So you see, this one has improved. You see, there is a lot inside. In fact, what doesn't show is more important, really, than what does show.
When Louise was 21, her mother died. She signed up to study geometry at the Sorbonne.
The rules of geometry were everything to me because they were a symbol of stability and predictability, which is obviously what my father had not provided us with. I indicate my space and I put inside my fears. What is in this space is under my control.
For Louise, abstraction, spirals, repetitive motion is a calming influence. When she deals with thoroughly abstract motifs, that's like a sense of gaining stability and order, rather than allowing the more violent emotions to show through. She has a certain faith in the rules of geometry and mathematics, even though they haven't served her that well over her life. She always thinks maybe they could or would.
There were certain times where Louise could be quite aggressive. Louise could be quite destructive. You know, I'd walk in and I can just tell, like, oh, today is going to be a bitch. You know, and she would have one of these major things where it's like, everything is flying, everything is broken, things are being destroyed. If she's in a nasty mood, she wants to bang, tear something apart. She's really, I mean, it's almost primal in a strange way. But she's able to take those emotions and come up with a form. I think that's that gift of, you know, being in touch with the unconscious, and it's a gift.
Back in the 1930s, she worked as an assistant in the studio of Fernand Léger, an earlier giant of modern art.
Her life story is amazing. And it's particularly compelling because she's still alive and a very elderly woman. And so there is this sort of nostalgia surrounding it. When you meet her, you're almost sort of touching history.
Yes.
You know, you're making contact with a very long time ago.
The whole century.
The whole century.
It was Léger who told her she was a sculptor, not a painter. She says Léger took a shaving of wood and hung it under his shelf. Look, the wood turns round like this. This is sculpture. The passion for the third dimension came from him, she says. And this was when she first met the surrealists, with whom she's often associated.
Louise Bourgeois was living in the building that housed the Surrealist Gallery. Her relationship to those figures was certainly an ambivalent one. She found them, André Breton in particular, lordly and pontifical. She said Marcel Duchamp could have been my father. Now we know for her to describe someone as a father is not a compliment.
Un bon fermier découvrit un matin dans sa basse-cour une poule fort étrange.
There were no women among the surrealists. The women that were welcome were the rich women, which is an insult, really. There was no room for any of us, and certainly not of my rebellious attitude.
Louise met the art historian Robert Goldwater. He said he'd found a diamond. She said he was like her mother, not her father. They married and left Europe for America just before the outbreak of war. She was off to a brave new world where she would come of age as an artist. But she would always carry old Europe with her.
Not being in France during the war was what wore on her. She felt very guilty that she'd left, very much as if she was out of contact with the things that were happening to her community.
It was an aching feeling of guilt and anxiety associated with that exile and separation from her family. And so it is at that stage that we begin to hear about a reconstruction of the past.
This is where Louise came to live. They're on the east side of Manhattan throughout the 40s and 50s. And what inspired her was this skyline here, so different from the boulevards of Paris. She'd often come up onto the huge shared roof to work. This is where she did her totem pole statues. And those wonderful drawings of a woman with wild, long hair laughing and howling on the rooftops.
In America, anything goes. I need total freedom.
Nobody's going to tell me what to do. In Europe, you are absolutely the prisoner of an establishment.
I love this city, she wrote. Its clean-cut look, its sky, its buildings, its scientific, cruel, romantic quality. But skyscrapers meant different things to her. Freedom, but also loneliness. My skyscrapers, she said, are not really about New York. Skyscrapers reflect a human condition. They do not touch.
Logically, I became a sculptor because in sculpture, the rules are eternal and they do not fail you. If you do not put things right, they fall, they crash. But if you are careful and if you are a good sculptor, the relations do work as they should work in real life. And I mean, I imply by this, human relations should work. Well, they never do. This is why the need for eternally repeating the same quest from art.
Her husband was an expert in African and symbolist art. You can certainly feel the African influence.
Those figures, which are called personnages, stand for all those who were lost from her. One she has described as a portable brother that she could carry around from room to room. A kind of stand-in for a figure of the past.
She probably had difficulties, you know, making friends and fitting in here. I think that the work helped her in that way. It's a very primitive use of something in the world that holds spirit. For her, the work does hold something.
She even made her son, Jean-Louis, as a shaky little skyscraper. She felt ill at ease as an artist and as a mother.
She represents the woman as trapped by the house in which she is enclosed, but also as a giantess who's dragging this house around with her. She seems to have no fear of making work about what it is to be a mother, in a sense that art very seldom allows a mother to be shown as an ambivalent, exasperated person.
She's exploring the house and the things that go on in it. A house is the container of comfort.
And yet.
But, and yet, and yes. Yet it is also filled with secrets, with suppressed violence, with betrayal.
And she doesn't come out of her room now.
Yeah, she is her house. I don't think she likes having her windows cleaned. It's like Her house has become an extension of her body.
The subject comes back quite often, and it has to do with the good mother who provides milk. The same subject appeared in this drawing, where the milk comes down like this and falls on the floor, helping nobody, maybe if there is a cat, instead of being given to the girl. This is the portrait of the abandoned child.
What she was thinking about and worrying about in the late 40s, she's still thinking about and worrying about now. Louise has been expressing herself right from the beginning. I think even when she was making tiny little prints at her kitchen table, and how she dug into the copper plates and went over them and over them because she was trying to get at the feeling. And pretty soon the print kind of disappeared.
What with her three sons to bring up and the death of her father in 1951, the feelings were intense.
For 5 or 6 years, she's very active and acknowledged. And then the death of her father, a whole series of traumas about the stress of having a career, feeling unworthy, feeling that it competed with roles of mother and wife. And then she took herself out of it. She didn't really show in New York for almost a decade.
I grabbed the shores of America. Now, after I hit the shores here, I was taken by a fantastic depression. A fantastic depression. The depression, this is a different word. I was enraged and I did not know it. And I was turning it against herself.
She re-emerged in the 1960s from motherhood and depression. The new works were full of fear and dread, thick with sexuality and in new materials, marble, plaster, but also poured plastic. The forms are visceral and lumpy, like aliens from outer space, or the inside of your own body.
Her work is very, very sexual. It isn't just about some romantic notion, it's the reality of sex and desire and lust. One of the first sculptures of hers I ever saw was just a black vagina. And I was thinking, wow, hardcore. This is a great photo. I mean, it looks like a handbag. It looks like she just casually has it underneath her arm. And she calls it Little Girl. She completely takes away its...
threat.
Yeah.
Such work was radically different from the hard-edged minimalism that dominated the New York art scene at the time. It must have seemed very strange.
If you look at the story of art in the 20th century, there
is... Yeah, which is about purification, you know, always about purification. And then you see something like this, it's fucking incredible. You know, there is a cunt made out of two pricks. And it's unbelievable. But she found her perfect material when she found rubber. La Follette, yes. The famous kind of rotting penis, you know, that is made of rubber, right? Rubber, brilliant. You know, it had all that stuff of being a cosh. You know, what do we make out of rubber? We make dildos or we make coshes. Fantastic. You don't know whether this is actually fertile, milk-giving, breasty kind of thing.
It's quite feminine, isn't it?
Yeah, those fields of penises, you know, could be some weird genetic kind of disorder of the udder, in which, you know, suddenly there were thousands of teats And yet you kind of know, actually, this is like a fantasy.
Louise has been an inspiration to younger artists.
She does stuff that's so real, I can only touch it for a second and I feel sick. There's a sinister, controlling element, but then there's a nurturing thing, like you want to fall into it and sort of be cuddled by it, that's very soft and motherly. And that this incredible, powerful female artist should make such sexual organs so beautifully and so caringly. It's such heightened reality, it's beyond real. It's a microcosm of the whole world into that one maggot-like thing that's repulsive, but you wish the museum guard would look away so you could touch it and just have a bit, for a minute, bit of energy off it and touch Louise Bourgeois too.
Louise's themes and her new forms struck a chord with the rising feminist movement. She got involved alongside much younger women like Linda Nochlin, now professor at the Institute of Fine Arts in New York.
Well, this is The Institute by Louise Bourgeois, and a terribly accurate replica of the building we're standing in.
It looks exactly like her home in Choisy-le-Roi.
And that's because this building was imitated from French architecture.
Yes.
Louise was already in her 60s. In a time of radical eccentrics, she stood out.
She was wicked. She wasn't just witty, she was wicked. I mean, she liked making trouble in an interesting way.
Was Louise Bourgeois a feminist?
Yes, I think she was. And I'm not saying there is such a thing as feminist art per se. I mean, maybe holding up a flag saying goody women or something like that. That was not at all the kind of work she was doing. Her work, with its intense concentration on certain taboo areas, bodily function, bodily process, sarcastic references to body parts where you'd least expect them. All of that is absolutely part of the kind of art feminists make.
She called this piece Knife Woman.
This is really the subject of the woman. If the woman is frustrated or resentful for reasons that have to do with the long ago, the woman has to become defensive. She has to become defensive. She's nothing but a defense. That's all I have to say about this.
That interview was done in 1975, 2 years after the death of her husband.
That's Louise, I take it.
Yeah, Louise has this habit. Ever since her husband died, the house has become totally utilitarian. So she'll write on the walls and it says, "You are not allowed to steal my ideas and my symbols. You're not permitted to touch my images." Louise always had this feeling that people were taking images, and it's one of the reasons why she didn't show for a long time. I do the shows. You know, if you said, "Oh, you're the Tate," and she said, "Oh, you're going away to London for a week," forget it. I'd rather you be here. I don't need the show. When
all the images are... By the late 70s, Louise had an underground reputation, but she hadn't yet broken through to the mainstream. That was about to change. A young curator took on the task of going to Louise's house to catalogue her work.
She had most everything because she really hadn't sold very many works. I think she didn't want me to bring in a camera, so I drew little pictures of every sculpture. And I was up on a ladder going through all the papers and down in the cellar measuring the sculptures.
And it wasn't always an easy ride.
I could just ask a question in a certain way and it would make her so upset, so angry. And she would just really frighten me. And I realized it was best to just let the tantrum pass, and then she'd be very tired and grateful that I hadn't left or something.
At any point, she can turn on her nearest ally and say some hair-raising thing, which is not so much directed at them, is is it's an expression of her discomfort, her feelings of being threatened by the very thing that she wishes to embrace.
Debbie saw it through and staged the first major retrospective of Louise's work at the Museum of Modern Art in New York in 1982.
The world and the art world was catching up to what Louise was doing. She didn't change at all, but we all changed in what we were expecting from art. It just gave her such greater confidence. She did feel much better and made more ambitious work. What's happened since, I just couldn't have dreamed of.
Louise was already at an age at which most artists are thinking of downing tools. But for her, it was a new beginning.
Louise made spider drawings in the 40s, but as a sculpture, it never came up until the 90s. There is this big spiral where things are just floating around in her unconscious and come and go.
She expands the book of life because the subjects that she brings to art don't exist in art until she brings them up. The mother's anxiety and ambivalence, the woman's experience of desire, the woman's experience of dread. She put a whole new set of terms on the table.
She has made her pain into form, and in that form, it is able to hurt us too. That's what Bacon does, that's what Munch does. I think that maybe all the greatest art of modernity suggests that anxiety is the thing we need to find form for, with no sense that it's going to be relieved, but part of the duty of being an artist and of exploring and of making the contemporary equivalent of what it means to be alive is to find the form for that anxiety, and that's what she does.
Louise Bourgeois' works expand and circle the globe. But Louise stays ever closer to home and digs ever deeper into her past.
This is my favorite object of the moment.
Ode to Forgetting.
The pages are made out of napkins embroidered from her trousseau with the initials of Louise Bourgeois Goldwater. And to see these stained linen napkins as pages of a book is really remarkable. And then she appliques the pages with fabrics from her past, from her closet. She doesn't go out now, so she doesn't need the wardrobe that she once had. So I think this idea of looking back over her life has been very poignant and very affecting to me. It's just a book. It's not a big room-sized sculpture, but I think it's as potent as anything that she's done. I had a flashback of something that never existed.
Si on le fait marcher pendant la nuit, on s'endort. Ça s'arrête tout seul. On n'a plus besoin de s'occuper de lui.
Louise s'est mise à dessiner toutes les nuits. C'est fait dans un espèce de demi-sommeil, dans cet état où, très proche de l'inconscient, où les images sortent quasiment toutes seules.
The landscapes of the night have invaded the days.
It's obsessive, intensive. In a way, it's a kind of mania. It was like she had dwelt in this place. And it could have been the circles of hell or just raindrops falling on the surface of a still pond.
These are the drawings she made yesterday.
So is this a scene that she's been...
She's been doing this, the mother and child, sort of surface and resurface.
They're very beautiful.
Yeah, they're very... But this is Louise, and this is Louise. That's what's so fascinating. She doesn't see herself as this. She sees herself as that. I think she's misses her mother and wants a mother. She needs someone to take care of her. She's fragile.
After the salon, Louise's son, Jean-Louis, and her friends stay to talk.
Am I going too fast?
Yes, that's good. Yeah.
This is the one.
I like this one too.
Yeah. Yeah, this is great. And this is a girl child.
This one?
Yeah.
Is this you, Louise, with your mother?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Very nice.
Very nice.
And this is relatively new. She hasn't done things where there's this kind of washy quality
before.
The
watery.
And it's just so beautiful. Yeah.
Why do you like the red so much?
I don't know. It's my favorite color. Mm-hmm.
Does it have a specific meaning?
No.
No? All these drawings are red.
Yeah.
It's called a jealousy over the breast. Louise, can I show them the big silk screen?
Yeah.
It's not, can I show you one other thing?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Oh, this is great.
Oh, wow.
This was a magic marker drawing. Thank you.
To me, she seems frightened to have all this responsibility of the baby.
Who do you identify with, the mother or the baby?
The mother or the baby? The mother.
Or the baby?
Yes, the mother.
The mother.
The mother.
It's probably Jean-Louis there.
I don't recognize
but you did.
Mother.
How are
you? Good.
Good.
Nice to see Rob.
Is that Jean-Louis? Is that you?
This actually looks more like my brother. I explained that I liked it very, very much because there was a cat.
Is it a bit fatigué maintenant? You are a little bit tired, right?
Oui, on va aller.